हेलो हेलो
या शुमा जी शरण
या चरण, क्लास
या
स्टार्टेड?
नो नो स्टिल नॉट स्टार्टेड आई थिंक
ओके फाइन फाइन. हेलो
हेलो नो या
हेलो हेलो
थैंक यू या हाय एवरीवन
या गुड इवनिंग
या
हे हाय
हाय हाय टुडे इज हेलो
हेलो
ऑल ऑफ यू कुड हियर मी ऑल ऑफ यू ऑनलाइन
यस क्लियर क्लियर
यस यस
यस फैंटास्टिक शैल वी गो अहेड और शैल आई वेट फॉर सम मोर टाइम
इज एनीबॉडी टू जॉइन
आई एम नॉट श्योर दैट एंड मिस्टर चरण नीड टू कोऑर्डिनेट
Somebody is going to join me, but otherwise we can start.
You can, yeah, you can wait 4 minutes, then you can start.
Yeah. Okay.
7:35, you can start.
Yeah.
Okay. Fine. Fine.
Anywhere that carbon data set is not available.
The local data set are in jail. But that microbiology structure, how it spreads, are that. At least we can deepen. హెడ్ఫోన్ అయితే after exam also can sit at Sunday. The date also can relax.
I will go for lunch and
dinner.
I will be coming later only.
Then you need to give power. Okay. Then you can shut down mine. Na? Nothing yes. More I'm going to.
Anything for recurrence? Ma'am, that laptop password if I draw it.
నీ ల్యాప్టాప్ లో ఫాస్ట్ గా ఇది ఆడిబిలిటీ బాగుంది అవుట్పుట్. నా ల్యాప్టాప్ లో ఆడిబిలిటీ బాగుంది.
Okay.
What time will be coming? 8:30. 8:15.
Ah, slow. Well, please slow. Then if at all required,
that is that setting. I don't know.
That I have a problem.
Yeah, you can start.
Yeah. Good evening, all of you. Today we are starting introduction to Python and hands-on. Before starting, I would like to know from each one of you, do you have this software to work with Python, either Jupyter Notebook or Spider or Atom, anything else? If not, I guide you with online without even installing. No need of any software need to be installed. But however, you may need to have internet. Once the internet connection is there, you can work with the Python coding or deep learning, machine learning, any kind of concept you can go ahead with. May I hear from you? May I know?
Yes, yes, we already downloaded this Jupyter Notebook.
Yeah, you have Jupyter Notebook, right? Yeah, fine, fantastic. Okay. If not, let me know if you don't have software or struggling to install software, then I will guide with Google Colab, which again,
okay.
Both ways comfortable, whichever you have. If comfortable in installing, if you have already Jupyter Notebook, we no need to worry.
Okay.
Yeah, very first, when you are going with Jupyter Notebook, this file menu, we may need to use this for creating new notebook or open the existing notebook, making a copy of the notebook, something like this. Then edit, it is used each, the entire notebook is termed as cells. Each cell, Python work like an interpreter. Let me open new notebook. I think I may able to show you, I don't know. Let me try. Python new notebook, Python 3. It starts opening. Could you able to see Python 3 new notebook? Demo. I'm giving demo.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, that's it. So this is termed as cell. Each cell capable of doing computation. Casually without even knowing Python, I'm writing 2 plus 4. Shift plus enter. It is giving me result 6. 2 divided by 4. It's giving me result 0.5. 5 plus 6, shift and enter, it gives me 11. That's it. It's like a calculator and it will support Python programming. The advantage of Jupyter Notebook is it works like an interpreter. We can write a tiny module. We can see the output. Once if it is comfortable, we can sail with. Whereas other IDE, we may need to write the entire program. We may need to compile like how other conventional language we are doing, or we may need to select the line number up till that line number we want to work on, something like that we need to give. Let's say this is a simple way we need to understand. Suppose I want to convert this cell into text form. Suppose I'm giving introduction instead of this. This is introduction class. Something like this, I am introduction session, something I'm writing. Is and class, both are keywords of Python. That's why it is marked as green. Let it be. I can select this cell, go to this code markdown heading. I can use it as markdown. Then the moment it is marked down, it becomes a text. If I run the cell, it gives me a text. Or else we can use heading. This for just giving heading. I'm converting this as heading. Whatever the way we want, we can treat using this. If you want to write your code, by default, each and every cell of Jupyter Notebook will be treated as a code. If we want to convert it as text, we can convert it into markdown. So self-explanatory notebook we can create. Heading, we can give you a heading for each and every section of the notebook for the self-explanatory. Here I can write something like that. This is a simple mathematical calculation, or this is introduction class. So something like that, beyond the comment line, this all will help us to decorate the notebook for the self-explanatory learning or teaching. That is the use of this. Then run the code. Nothing else we may require other than this. So we may go to insert, above cell. I forgot to type one command before this. Then I can create a cell above it. then I can here use 34 plus 56, enter. Yes, I am done in the sequence. That's it. Then where, which cell we want to delete, we can delete, or simply you can cut it. So it's over cut. It has moved down. Then you can move the cell from down. Instead of 34 plus 54, it was above. Now I want to move back. That's it. I want to move back further. So this I wanted to retain as the first cell. That's it. These are all the simple navigation we may need to understand, nothing more. Shift enter we can use. Just you can go to the first cell, shift enter, shift enter, shift enter. It will keep on moving to all the cells. Very quickly, very fast you can do. This introduction is sufficient, I think so. Here you can name the notebook any type, demo, day one, any kind of thing you can use, rename. These all will be available in your homepage of Jupyter Notebook. This demo is sufficient, I think so. Let's move back to what it is. Now only we are entering into Python. Earlier the demo was with Jupyter Notebook, how all it works, what is cell, how to run the cell, how we can treat it as a text matter, how we can treat it as a coding matter, something like that. We were doing like a calculator, 5 plus 6, 34 plus 56, something like that we did. Now let's go back to Python. It's a case sensitive. The moment we talk like case sensitive, there is a difference between small letter and the capital letter. The moment I write anything in terms of age like this, both are different. Age capitalized, age small letter, both are different in nature. Next, what is identifier? Identifier is a placeholder or memory location to hold something, whatever the data we give. When we look at this notebook, Jupyter Notebook, we haven't used any of them. We haven't used any of the coding here. Just we started giving the direct number data, 34 plus 56 data we started giving, it started producing the result. Upon this operator, it started working. Whereas the moment we want to store the data to do many more steps, we may require variable. Variable is kind of placeholder. It will carry the value or the number or depending upon the data type. So that is identifier. Next, when we start doing Python coding, we may need to remember all the time indentation. Indentation in the sense, we can see few example for indentation. If you look at the statement for I plus range of 0 comma 10 something, very immediate line, I'm giving some space and I'm starting here if. Again, second statement, within if, I'm giving some more space, I'm starting here printf. This is called indentation. Certain conditioning or looping or functions, we may need to write the body of the control, the body of statement, we may need to push it inside. So that is indentation. That indentation always we may need to remember. Sometime we may good at coding, or we may would have written coding rightly, but indentation will create a lot of trouble while executing or compiling. So that normally four spaces considered for each level. In the previous example, again, we will be looking back. In the previous example, for again, one level had come with if. Within if, one more level had come. The level can keep on moving. Each level we may need to, minimum we need to give four spaces. Whenever we start writing a program coding, the statement should be limited to 79 characters. Beyond the 79 character, for example, this is character, the length of the statement or sentence. So if it goes more than 79, we can continue with backslash. The moment we continue with backslash, it's treated that it's a continuation of the previous statement. The next is, for example, long multiple statement, we can use backslashes. Next, identifier. These are all termed as identifier. Age, capital H, small H. These all identifier. We can create any naming convention, but it has certain rules. There are three major way termed as camel case, snake case, Pascal case. Any variable capitalized with collection of words. For example, age of an employee. I want to use age of an employee. Once again, I'm giving. I want to give age of employee, age of a person, age of a citizen. So many things we have. So I want to distinguish age of employee. So the first word age, second word starts with capital. Whenever we capitalize the meaning of each and every context, then it is camel case. Next, snake case. Whenever we use underscore, snake underscore case, it's a camel. This is snake case. Next is Pascal case. What user login count? Almost Pascal case and the capitalized words will look like same, but they have three different conventions. Python will allow underscore for naming convention instead of the cap words. We can use underscore also. Underscore can be used in the beginning of the identifier. Other languages will not allow underscore in the beginning of the identifier. However, in the practical convention, no one is encouraged to use underscore in the beginning because there are special interfaces, inbuilt interfaces already starts with underscore in Python. So we need to restrict the reader of the program or any other stakeholder when they follow your programming code, they may get confused whether it is interface or whether it is a variable. So we need, however it gives up freedom, we may need to stick to using the underscore middle of the identifier. Next, this is the case, and it can start with underscore variable, but we should not use it in the practical convention because concept called private variable already it starts using the underscore predefined variable. Then next, all the keywords in the sense reserved predefined words in the computer world for the Python language, the keyword normally it would be in the lowercase letter, in the smaller letter, except two keywords, true and false, Boolean representation, true stands for one, false stands for zero. These two are represented with the capitalized keyword. Normally, what is a keyword? The moment I say this is my laptop, I cannot change. Instead of laptop, I cannot call this as a bread. People will laugh at me. The word is predefined, occupied in human mind, occupied in the book form, occupied in the written form. So I cannot change the meaning of laptop. Whenever the moment I use laptop or to talk about laptop, I'm supposed to use laptop. I cannot replace. It has its own meaning. It has its own context. It has its own weightage. Similarly, every computer language have got its own set of keywords, predefined words. Each word expected to do predefined operations. Next, Python will allow assigning values to multiple variable. If you look at A, B, C is equal to these three. Within the assignment operation itself, Python, we may need to go a lot. Oh, really, one book is there. I will share in the group. Whenever you feel free, you can go through that. Most of the time, even you can put forth in your resume that you are following this kind of textbook. That are all standard textbooks for referring Python. So they will be dealing a chapter exclusively for how to deal with assigning values or assignment operator, simple equal to operator. What are all the way we can use? What are all the what is the power, real power of equal to operator in Python? It deals a lot. But for the introductory part, we are discussing. It allows multiple assignment, A, B, C. The correspondence is 1000 goes to A, 2000 goes to B, 3000 goes to C. That order we may need to maintain. Next, when we come to operator, one operator we have discussed, that is assignment operator. Similarly, we have arithmetic operator, we have logical operator, we have relational operator. There are set of operators we will be looking at. Those operators, if it possesses same precedence, then the associativity of evaluation is considered left to right. What that means, precedence, let us see one example. I'm writing A plus B plus C. in such a circumstances, now no need to worry. There is no different two operators I'm using. I'm using the same operator, plus and plus. How I need to evaluate? Computer will question us. We, the compiler designer, may need to fix this problem. If such situation arises, this expression need to be evaluated from A plus B plus C order or C plus B plus A order. That is called associativity. When it has equal precedence, both are equal important, or they both are equal to each other. In such a situation, the evaluation of operation should go from left to right. This direction to this direction it goes. This is the direction of evaluation, left to right manner. Next, PEMDAS rule they used to call. When more than one operator, mixed mode operator used, then how the priority, who is need to be given very first attention is, in short form, in the technical world, people are calling PEMDAS rule. What it is parenthesis will have highest priority, exponentiation second, division, multiplication, addition, subtraction, etc. In a short form, we can term it as PEMDAS rule. What is PEMDAS rule? Let us understand once again. For example, I'm using here A, open bracket, A plus B star D. In such a case, how I need to give importance, or compiler, how it evaluates? Compiler will start giving priority for this parenthesis, because the PEMDAS rule says parenthesis will have the highest priority. Next, exponentiation. It is not a matter. Since parenthesis is available, A plus B will get evaluated before even star. Although addition has the least priority, multiplication has highest priority, it will start evaluating A plus B first. To understand this, the precedence rule, you can try just, if I say 2 plus 3 into 7, what would be the answer of this? It will lead to two different answers. How that? If you look at, if you try to calculate 2 plus 3, first, then it would be 5. 5 into 75, then it would become 5 into 75, the answer would become 35. Whereas if I start computing this first, 3 plus 7, 14, 21. 21 plus 2, 24. There are two different answers. In order to avoid this kind of ambiguity, they fix with these all the precedence rule and associativity rule. In such a case, this precedence will help. Across all the circumstances, it should behave in similar manner. Here they are giving importance for the parenthesis first, exponentiation second, division first, multiplication. Now, if we do simply, if we write 2 plus 5, 2 plus 3 into 7, anybody's computer will give 35 only the answer. Never we get 24. Because the priority is given for parenthesis. Sorry, here no parenthesis. Then it will give priority for multiplication. We will get only 24. Never we will get 35. The moment if I use bracket of 2 plus 3 bracket into 7, this would lead to 35. If I don't mention this parenthesis bracket, immediately answer we will be getting 34. When we apply human brain, the way in which we evaluate, it lead to 35 and 24. When we don't use parenthesis, it will give 24 as answer. So this is what PEMDAS rule. Next, the order of addition and subtraction is also the same. Addition and subtraction, there is no biggest priority among itself. The moment if I write 2 plus 2 plus 3 minus 4, something like this, then both are equal priority, both are having equal power, both are chief minister, both are prime minister, that's it. So there is no difference between this fellow and this fellow. In such a situation, what it does, how it executes, or how it considers, in such a situation only this associativity will play a role. Associativity stands for what direction I need to work on. Since both are having equal power, in what direction I need to work. So this plays a role. If the precedence or priority becomes same, it will consider the associativity. Next term. These are all the, IDEs we can use. Any kind of competitive exam, if you undergo an online exam, certification exam for Python, you may refer Python for data science also. SandFoundry.com has 1,000 questions on Python alone, 1,000 questions on data science alone. It will work differently. Data science theory, the way we discussed yesterday, how that formula is useful, how this formula is useful, what way we need to infer, something like that. So those kind of questions for each and every data model, it has 1,000. So totally we may have 2,000 questions if we go across this website. Thus, that 2,000 questions are more than enough to think a wider perspective and crack any kind of exams. I'm just introducing this to websites, that's it. Let's move forward. Next, if we use --- version, you will come to know the version of the Python. Next, variable convention age, we may need to start with alphabet and we may need to continue with number and alphabet. I can write age 1, age 2, age 3, something like that. Now again for associativity demonstration, we may look at, see, this is exponentiation symbol. This is power symbol in Python. 2 to the power of 2 is represented by 2 double star 2. 2 to the power of 3 is represented by 2 double star 3. When there are two operators only involved in this expression, both are of same nature, both are having equal power, then how I can execute? Computer will question us. So fixing this problem only, compiler designer will use left to right associativity. It will be common whichever the machine we use, wherever we execute this expression 256. Next, this is one more operator, remainder operator. This will give remainder after division, 23 divided by 3. It goes how many times, then what would be the remainder? So that remainder is obtained through this operator. Modulo operator, a remainder operator, a percentage operator, whatever we want, we can call it as. Then data set platform, yesterday we discussed, once again I'm emphasizing, we can get back all the data set from the Kaggle, GitHub, UCA machine learning repositories. There are a few YouTube channels and websites I would be recommending for your self-learning and practices. One such website all the data scientists should able to look at is 3 Blue 1 Brown mandatorily. This guy is rocking a lot with mathematics, with animation. He is illustrating the underneath principles of each and every model. What exactly, what is the meaning, each terminology, each buzzword of machine learning, he starts creating a animated video. We can understand how internally each and every component works, how mathematically it works. That is the beauty of this. Likewise, this is yet another website. This fellow also does very great job. He is also doing animation, but he is giving interpretation for the mathematical model. A very fabulous way he is articulating the mathematical for human understanding. Whereas this person giving mathematical with a fabulous way of presentation with animation also. That is a highlight of these two websites. That's it. Predominantly towards data science, we will be using. These are all the packages. The moment package is used, what is all about package? Do any one of you can narrate what is package, why we are going to the concept called package? What is mean by package?
Collection of?
Yeah.
Collection of items.
Yeah, collection of related items combined under one folder. It's a package. Why we need to go for packages? If you look at our dictionary also, all the words are not dumped at a time. It is archived under alphabet A, it is archived under alphabet B, archived under alphabet C. Any word starts with C, immediately we can go there and the C will be used. If the power of language becomes more and more, the power of computational power, richness of computation, application of the language becomes more and more, the length of the compiler, the memory occupancy of the compiler will become very, very complex. We may not be able to accommodate the entire compiler on the machine. We may not be able to deploy or whatever use. So that what they are doing, they are segregating all the operations and the functionalities into different folders. Then on demand, whenever the user interested to use it according to their application or according to their need and circumstances, they can bring back to the notebook or whatever the IDE they are working, that so that their memory will be reduced. The complexity of loading the compiler, working with the compiler is reduced. The moment the memory is reduced, time will be improved. It is inverse proportion, trade-off always. The moment the memory is becoming more, time will become more. I mean, direct proportion, sorry. The moment the memory is lesser, time is also lesser. That is a reason it is categorized into packages. So we will be discussing NumPy, numerical operations, anything we do with matrix, numerical operations, computation, all the not like simple numerical plus addition, all like finding out the determinant of the matrix, finding out inverse of the matrix, transpose of the matrix, eigenvalue of the matrix. To find the eigenvalue, it may take really, if you do it on a paper for 3x3 matrix, it may take maybe 20 minutes to half an hour, depending upon your expertise and the numerical accuracy. But with this NumPy package, maybe with a couple of lines of coding, in a minute, in a second, we may able to obtain the answer. That is the power of numerical operations. Next is pandas. This is what mainly or predominantly we will be using across the entire data science principle. Without this, we may not be able to read the file at all. Using pandas only, we will be reading either Excel file, text file, or CSV file, any kind of file. File reading, it is mainly important. Now, the file is started low. So the moment we start reading the file, the entire content of the file needs to be loaded onto your primary memory. That primary memory, the larger amount of data, 10,000 records, 1 lakh records, 40,000 records. I can give you a data set with 60,000 records also. So how the entire 60,000 records goes and sits? That data structure which we use to hold larger amount of data for the operation or for the activities to perform computation, it is termed as data frame. Simple, that's it. We are using larger amount of data. That data need to be loaded into primary memory. Once if it is loaded only, anything we want, even though we do sum of two column, a simple addition of two column, it needs to be loaded into primary memory. Only then we can add two columns, adjacent two columns, we can start adding this column value, and we can create one more column with the answers, something we are filling. A very tiny operation we are doing, but the data is larger amount that needs to be loaded into data frame. Next, matplotlib. This is useful for visual plot. Anything visually we are seeing that can be used matplot. There are plenty of packages available. Normally, people tend to use matplotlib for all the visual plot. Next is seaborn is also used for visual plot, but it has a lot of advanced plots and aesthetic appeal also much better than matplotlib. More and more beautification if you want to do, we can do. Similarly, more and more computational related thing we want to do, advanced computation with the visual also, we can use seaborn. Beyond that, Skikit-learn, this is the hero of the entire data science. This Skikit-learn only making machine to learn using the data and your coding or the algorithm or model which you are using. The entire hero, the remaining all are supporting packages. This is a hero of the package for the machine learning. Next, coming to data structure, since we are using data of larger in nature, both column wise and row wise, we are trying to use larger size, both column wise and row wise, we are trying to use larger amount of data. when we use larger amount of data, how to deal with this data? We may need to undergo a lot of data structures. How can I hold the entire row alone? How can I hold the entire column alone? Or how can I hold mixed data type, string, numerical, these all mixed data type, how can I hold? Then we may need to undergo a data structure. What all about data structure? It's a placeholder. It starts holding the data depending upon its nature. Numerical has its own ability. I can hold this differently. The moment I go to the floating point, 24, the moment I use floating point, 12.0. Yes.
Hello. Can you please repeat it, please?
Data structure is a placeholder.
Okay.
Placeholder, for example, we will be, the moment I say I will be giving you 5 kg rice, the moment I am giving you, donating, okay, or gifting you 5 kg rice, the vessel which you carry will be different.
Mm-hmm.
Immediately I'm telling, tomorrow I will give you 5 liter milk for you. The vessel which you choose for holding the liquidity item will be different.
Okay.
Day after tomorrow I'm telling you, I will give you 5 kg of LPG gas. The moment you bring the container, the way in which you open the container and the way the container size, everything will be different. That, okay, decided by the item which I give you. The container which you brings to me to carry my gift is depending upon the gift which I am giving you.
Okay.
Similarly, the data nature, which data we are using, depending upon that, we need to choose a container to hold data. However, our hands are big, we may not be able to carry 5 kg rice at a time. We may need to, we may need to carry a container to move from one place to another place, or to access day-to-day life to access also. So similarly, the data need to be placed in a container or placeholder later on for the computational activity that is to be done with the primary memory. That's the reason data structure is much more important.
Okay.
To hold the data, numerical data, integer data, 12, the data structure which we choose will be different. To hold this 12.24 is different. Similarly, to hold the character data, simple A is a character. Then collection of character is said to be a string. This is one string, low is another string, this is another string. Then if I want to hold the entire sentences or the entire paragraph, then the data structure would be different. Similarly, I said now previously, to hold the entire column, entire row, the data structure would be different. To hold the entire data file, the Excel file is called data frame. That is already we have seen data frame. Then now different or other special data structures. This data structure, we may need to understand, it has its own characteristics. The way we buy butterfly water container will be different from the street water container or water bottle. Butterfly water bottle, the nature and its services or usage functionality is different. Whereas the street wala who is selling the water bottle, its feature is different. Similarly, each and every container, it has its own restriction, its own features that we are going to undergo. Primarily, we will be discussing about list, tuple, set, dictionary, string. Actually, I computed this. 1 minute. Let me put back. Before computation, it was originally, it was, yeah, this is the exact data structure. Python data structures are primarily list, tuple. These are all essential when we deal with data processing. Then each and every data structure has its own way of usage. We may need to undergo. The moment I would like to speak some other language, Spanish, I supposed to know how I need to speak, what is a vocabulary, what is a grammar structure. It's like that each and every data structure has its own limitation, its own constraint or advantages, disadvantages, the way of usage. That all we may need to learn. That's it. But primarily, for the naming convention, we are using it's a list, next tuple, next sets, next dictionary, next string, array, and matrices. So these are all the predominantly used data structure in the Python programming. Let us see one by one. Today, I'm just introducing this data structure. Now we are slowly getting into a coding. I'm using variable one. I'm using variable. If you don't like, we can use it as a, for example, age. The moment I change variable one as age, I need to change everywhere age. This is called a placeholder. This is a placeholder starts holding the value 10. It's an integer value holding. What is another beauty? I can say that it's a blessings of Python. We no need to worry about data type, what data we are assigning. The moment we are assigning the value after the equal to operation, automatically this data structure will take metamorphosis. It will start adjusting itself how to deal with this fellow. We no need to worry of whether we are giving 10 or 10.10 or 10.5. We no need to worry of those things. Automatically it will take metamorphosis on the left hand side. Whereas all other conventional languages, it's very tedious. We may need to understand each and every data type. We may need to plan well. That is another curse of other languages. Here, 3.14, floating point. The human says it is a floating point. We no need to worry about speaking with a computer using Python language. Automatically, variable 2 will take metamorphosis to accustom the data, 3.1.4. Next, I am trying to give string. String can be given in double quotation also. String can be given in single quotation also. It doesn't make any difference. Both are same. I can give this Python in double quotation also. The moment I give this value on the right hand side, variable 3 will take metamorphosis. We no need to worry about how variable 3 is going to deal. That compiler designer who developed the compiler, they have taken care. We no need to worry. We are just giving, I want 10, I want 3.4, I want this. That's it. We will be giving our own demand. Then these are all three values we started assigning. Now age is carrying 10, variable 2 is carrying 3.1.14, variable 3 is carrying Python. We are printing all at a time. How we may need to print? We need to write the first print is the statement we need to use for display, or we need to print something, followed by open bracket, followed by the first variable age, comma. Here we are trying to give single quotation, pressing spacebar once to create the space between two different data. The moment we don't give this, we won't get space. Comma followed by variable 2. The value which is available in variable 2 is printed here. Then we want to create space for that, this structure we are using, then variable 3. That's it. So once if we use shift enter, it will give the result as 10.3.14 Python. That's it. Next, we are moving to earlier we have seen multiple values can be assigned to multiple variables. Now we are looking at same value can be assigned to multiple variables in a single statement. Whereas all other conventional language, we need to use variable one equal to one, variable two equal to one, variable three equal to one. Now, no need to write three times. Just say variable one equal to this. This one will sit across all the three placeholders or all the three variables. Then we are trying to print. It gives a result 1, 1, 1. Next, here if you look at, it's a same value, same data type. Whereas here, variable 1, comma variable 2, variable 3, what and all we are doing? Let us look at. We are giving 1, 2.5, comma Python. All the three assignments are different data type. Then 1 would go corresponding to variable 1. 2.5 would go corresponding to variable 2. Python would go variable 3. So this kind of assignment is also possible with Python. So when once the assignment is over, we are printing it. This space is up to you, whether you want to make it elegant to read it or not is up to you. You can create a space or you can skip the space. Now we are going for, this is again much more important or way to learn. Slicing operator again, it will have two way. One with numerical, one with integer. Both way we can learn. Now, what is slicing operator? Let us see. String equal to hello world. Something like that I am giving. How many character, what and all, we can sit and calculate later on. Now, just the moment I started assigning, I am printing it. Simple printing. It prints me as such. What I gave as an assignment value without even any modification, it gives me back perfectly. Whereas next, print string of zero. All the time, when it becomes collection, it will be starting with zero. The first address value is one. The address is two. The address is two. One, two. The address is three. For this four, space address is five. This is called six. Index value, or else you can call the index value all the time. How we are addressing, how we are accessing a particular character is called index. This starts almost all the language, not only C language, it starts with zero. So that I'm giving str of zero, this would give me h. Yes, it gives h. Next, now only the slicing operator comes into a picture. I think we remember what is the value residing in str. No need to use that. I just scroll down. Next, we are using str 2 colon 5. What that signifies is, starting from 2, we need to move forward. Again, we can look at this 1 minute. Clear? Even here we can look at. This is 0, this is 1, this is 2. So this is my beginning pointer. Here I say you should start from 2. So that it starts from L. How long I can go is the next question. Up to 5. Then this is 3, this is 4, this is 5. 5 normally will not be considered. In the Python language, the end value is not considered. The previous value is considered. Not because of this space also, it considers. That's it. 2 to 5, it gives me output LLO. That's it. Next, 2 colon. What that signifies? Start from 2. There is no condition. Go up to the end. So that this is 0, not my bread and butter. This is 1. This is what, right? I need to start from 2. Then if I start from 2, there is no restriction for me. I can go up to end. This is LLO world. Next, colon 2. What does mean? I don't know where you will start, end at 2. 2 is not, I said earlier, 2 is not considered. Beginning value is considered as such, but this is considered as previous value 1. That is why it starts 0 from the hello and 1. 2 is not at all dealt. That we may need to remember. Then colon, no restriction. Just print hello world. Then next. The star operation next. Str star 2. We may wonder how the string is operated. Str star 2. It doesn't matter. It will start repeating 2 times. That's it. Star plus something, hello, this is called concatenation operator. Earlier we have hello world, again we are having hello BVRIT. These two are concatenated. Anything which we want, we can concatenate. This is for replication. The moment I give instead of this 2, if I start giving 3, if I start giving 3 here, 3 times it will repeat. Okay. That's it. It will repeat. You can have trial once this notebook is shared with you. Next, n equal to Python. This is the value we are assigning. How to print it reverse? N, 1 minute. Python, P-Y-T-H-O-N. It is giving me in a reverse order. So for that, we may need to give n equal to n of. That n we are treating, and within that n, how we need to print, we are giving dot dot, no condition for the beginning, no condition for the end, but I am telling minus 1. Start from the reverse order. That minus 1 is said to be reverse order. Again, let us go back to this. The just now we have seen this h is called the index value 0, e is called the index value 1, l is the index value 2, another L is index value 3, 0, O is 4, space is 5, something like that. This is one way of indexing, forward indexing. There is another way represented in Python, reverse indexing. When I start reading this word in this direction, this exclamatory mark is labeled as minus 1, D is labeled as minus 2, this L is labeled as minus 1, minus 3, and so on. It will go in this direction. This is called reverse indexing. This is to use or access the given string in the backward direction from end to the beginning. That is what we are doing here. That's what we are doing here. So no specification for the beginning, no specification for the ending, whereas we are using minus 1. The moment we give minus 1 indication, it starts from the end or reverse of the string. This N is started, not the P, so that it starts printing, converting the original N as this N. Then we are printing after the conversion the same N. If you wish, we can use different variable also instead of this N. May I proceed further? Is that okay? The pace is okay?
Yes.
Yeah, fine. Now we are coming to the very first data structure called list. The list data structure. List will allow collection of data type, any data type. See, we are giving one string A, B, C, D. Next, we are giving one number 786. Next, we are giving this. John, mixed. Whatever we think, we are listing it. We will, when we go for a picnic, we will be writing down the list of item. We will write medicine, immediately fashion item, immediately snacks, immediately something. Paper, documents, all the list of items we'll write. We have freedom to write on a paper. Similarly, this list will allow us to have any data type, any item which we want. So that is a list. Next, tuple also allows us to create any kind of item mixed mode. But only difference between tuple and list is, if we look at carefully, we start and end with bracket for the list. Whereas for the tuple, we start and end with parenthesis. This is square bracket. This is curly bracket. Curved bracket, something like that. But what would be the difference? Next question. It allows same kind of information. Similar nature is there. Only the brackets are different. We are calling it as list. We are calling it as tuple. Then what would be the difference? The difference is, internally, once the tuple is created, it won't allow to place the name of Rajesh or Girish or Suman. It won't allow me to put here. Whereas list will allow. The day one, Suma was there, Rajesh was there. Day two, Girish was there. The moment the batch size grows, I can include their detail. It will allow me anytime. Not necessary to create the list in the day one. Any moment I am flexible to include any person name of the batch. Whereas tuple won't allow. The day one itself, I should know who are all participating in this Zoom meeting. I should know very clearly. I should create Once if I am created, I may not be able to insert again. That is the difference between list and tuple. What is the use then? So whenever there is a chance of modifying the data structure, internally operating system will take care of this differently. The moment we are telling nobody will come and disturb me during the Zoom meeting, then what is the meaning? We no need to worry, no, we no need to be afraid, no. Especially if we sit at home, people will be coming and knocking the door. That's why I'm using office space whenever I am hosting this meeting, so that there is no disturbance for me. So that is like the tuple. The moment it is freezed, so internally the speed of the computation will be increased in nature. That is the first advantage of using tuple. Now, how to print the list? Simple, print the name of the list. List, not necessarily to use list. You can use L1, L2, Priya, P1, anything you can use. It is a kind of variable name. That's it. So print list. Then it prints me this list. This is the output of the first print. What I gave, that is printing. That's it. Then print a list of zero. Just so we have looked at, most of the time the index starts from zero. Now ABCD is represented with zero index. 786 is represented with one index. This fellow is sitting at the position 3. This fellow is sitting at the position 4. This fellow is sitting at the position 5. That's it. So next, I'm accessing, I am exclusively particular about, I want this guy. I don't want anyone else. So list of zero. So that the first person is coming out. Whereas here, slicing operator we are using, I'm telling I want the person from 1 to 3. It doesn't mean that 3, it means that 2. For human, it should be 2. For machine, it can be 3. So what I am doing now, 1, 2, 3. Tuple, I am telling. This fellow is 0. So my interesting person or interested person starts from here. 1. This person is of my interest. This is of my second interest. Stops. So I cannot access John because this 3 is not meant for John. It ends with, for the computer, it ends with 2. For the human only, we are seeing 3. That is ceiling limit we are telling. That's it. So it gives me my interested person 786, 2.23. Similarly, next one, I think these all you can work it out later on. How I am deleting, how I am inserting, and sorted. The moment we say sorted, it will sort the entire content. Irrespective of the order which we use, it will sort and give us. List has a lot of operations. Maybe at the max 10 operations it will have, that's it. So that all operations on demand you can learn. Nothing to learn as such. We may need to be familiar and versatile with the creating list and deleting list and accessing list, what specificity we want, whom we are interested to display or handle. Those things are enough.
Okay.
Notebook will be shared, you can work on. That's it. Now we are going for looping statement, slicing much more important operation, or we may need to understand thoroughly. That's over. Enough example illustrated for slicing. Only two data structures we touched upon, only list and tuple. That also very introductory level. Next, let us look into conditioning and looping. Looping statement, perhaps all of you may be aware that it is to repeat certain number of statements under its control again and again is looping statement. For is one such a looping statement. So the keyword used is for, followed by the control variable. This person is controlling this entire loop. How many times to use, how to use that control. Then followed by the keyword in, followed by range. For has different variants. It has different variants. Predominantly we use this variant, this kind of skeleton, range, followed by zero. Again, here also we need to remember, for a human it is telling 10. But for the computer, it is going to become 9, 0 to 9. It starts taking the value from 0. If we don't mention third component incremental step, for example, 0, 10, 2. if I mention like this within the range, here keyword comes range. What it does, it starts with zero. Next, it looks at this. It says that increment with two. My next value would be zero followed by two. Next value will be four. Next is six. Next is eight. It won't go after eight. Because the moment I increase plus two, my ceiling is not 10, my ceiling is 9. So that the value generated by this loop for I would be, these are all the five values. Then we may need to mandatorily use colon. Mostly we are using this colon for for, if statement, else statement, function definition we will look at, def. For these two only we will use colon. That's it. For these four, else, if else is treated as same family. I don't treat it as different. So for, if and def. So whenever we use this, maximum 90% we will use colon. End limiter. No other statement will have end limiter. So what it does, it start doing square of each and every number, whatever given or specified in this range. If I mod 2, this is modulo operator, we have discussed that it is a reminder. Any number pulled out from this range or given by this variable, if we take modulo operator, if it becomes 0, when it will become 0? Any number is divided by 2, when the remainder will become 0. What is remainder is? All of us know, no? 10 divided by 2. What is the remainder?
5.
Remainder, that is quotient.
0.
Exactly, that is remainder. So now I'm using 3 divided by 2 remainder. Divided means we can keep on dividing with precisions, but I don't want, I need to end with the integer. Now remainder comes. The remainder is 1. Because one time only 2 can become a multiplicand factor of the given number n. After the moment I increase 2 into 2, 4, it is lesser than this. Then what would be my remainder? 1. 7 mod 2. What would be the remainder now? Multiplicative factor of 3, sorry, 2 would be 3. Up to 3, 3 into 2, 6. The moment I increase the multiplicative factor 4, it goes, exceeds this 7. So that I can't go with 4. So I need to stop at 3. Then 3 into 2, 6, the remainder would be 1. Hope so you are clear with what is modulo operator, means remainder operator. Shall I proceed? May I proceed? Are you clear with remainder? Am I audible? Hello.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah. This I starts with 0, goes to 10. So how many times it would go? 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. And so on, up to 9 it will go. So when the remainder would be 0, only for even number, 2, 4, 6, 8, only 4 numbers it does. The moment the number remainder gives us 0, we want to square it up. That's all. There is no other logic. Else, we are trying to tell the number, I don't want to square because that number is odd. When the remainder is not 0, then that is, if the remainder is not 0, that is odd number. The moment remainder is 0, that becomes even number. This is the logic we are using. Just we are getting acquainted with how to use for, how to use if else. This is called indentation. Exactly four spaces after this for. See, the for is starting with the line number one, column number one. Whereas this if I am starting with the column number four. Another printf under the control of if, starting another four more spaces. From the beginning it is eight spaces. So this is called indentation, already we discussed. So this indentation we need to take care, otherwise error at time we get or wrong output which is not expected by us we would be getting. So all the even numbers are considered for squaring it. All other odd numbers are displayed that it is odd number, it is odd number, it is odd number. Only even numbers are done. At the end, we started using the loop, print loop done. So that it ends with loop done. Now we are going for functions. Within the function, we are looking into built-in functions, predefined already available function. Sum of list of items. This is called list. Although we didn't tell explicitly, wherever we see the square bracket, it is a list. It has four values, 1, 2, 3, 4, four values it has. So all the four values we are expecting, we are dictating to sum using the built-in function sum. It starts doing the sum for us. The result of 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 is 10. Next, again list operation only we are discussing. We are finding length of the list. Same list we are supplying to length also. It give us the length. How many elements are sitting is said to be a length. ABS. Most of the time we would be using this four. All the four we would be using. ABS is for absolute value. When the negative value is passed on, it will convert it into positive value. If the positive value is passed on, again it will give positive value only. Nothing more is the modification. Round function, it will round up to the integer value, although we pass the float value. If after the point, if it is more than 5, it will show 2 round value. Next, log value. Whenever we use log, we may need to import the math package. Very first time we are looking into package. The first package what we are seeing is math package. How to bring this package to our work, to our notebook is the discussion. We need to use the keyword import. What is the name of the package we want to use, give here, and we need to give as. We need to create alias name empty. If you don't want to use alias name, this part is not required, just to use math. But instead of here, you may need to use math all the time, you need to write. To shorten, to use the alias name, we are creating this empty, as empty. Next, print log value, empty.log. It gives us log value for the 10. Log value of 10 is 2.3. Normally, it will have the base 2. Whenever we find log, it will consider base 2. Shall we proceed? Now we are, now we are getting into user defined function. Earlier we have seen sum, length, ABS, round. These are built in, predefined. Compiler of the Python donates us. We are enjoying that benefit. We no need to worry how to do length, round, ABS. The moment we know the syntax or the function name, we can take the advantage of the utility. But whereas how we need to write our own function. What is function is, it can be used n number of times with different input values. Again and again, it will allow us to use or supply different values and to see different outputs. That is the use of function here. Function is a modular component. It helps us to plug in wherever we require. n number of times with n input to obtain n output. That is a function. Now we are defining our own function. This is user defined function. We are defining the name of the function as area. Def followed by area followed by what this function is going to do. Upon what? I am telling you to calculate sum of two number. The moment I say all of you sit and calculate sum of two number, you would be questioning me. Tell me the number, then only I can calculate sum of two number. Unless otherwise I give you the number 20 and 30, you cannot sit and do the sum of two number. Similarly, we are telling area. But upon what it is going to calculate area? There must be some value. For that, we are giving two parameters. One is length, another one is width. Length and width we are passing. Function definition is over here. Function definition ends with semicolon. Again, a caution. For is a statement ended with semicolon. If is a family of if, both if and else ended with colon. Def is also function definition, user defined function is also ends with colon. Already I said these three predominantly we use, it ends with colon. Now what we are doing, very simple operation we are doing, length and width. These are all the two parameters it started taking from the person who is calling or anyone who is calling this function and taking the operation multiplication and it returns it. Now, how to invoke the function? We started defining the role of the function, what it's supposed to do, how it's supposed to do. But who is going to take the advantage of this function? Here that goes on. Function invocation or function call is happening here. The name is matched area and area. And 10, 20 is passed on. 10 is associated with length. 20 will go and sit with width. Then what it does immediately, the length will be substituted back here, width will be substituted back here, and it computes and it returns. Whomever calls this function, it returns the value 10 into 20, 200. 200 will go and sit in ARE. That ARE we are trying to print, so it becomes 200. That's it. Is it clear now, definition? Shall I proceed?
Yes.
Now we are, this is just introduction. Now we are touching again the flavor of data science because it's a data science course. So at least a couple of use cases we need to discuss. Then we will wind up the session in 10, 15 minutes. Now we need to study the case. Given below are the ages of students from Kendra Vidyalaya. We are building a machine learning model that uses the age of the student as a feature. However, something changed. However, what is the thing is, this is the question. The data is given. We need to find out erroneous value, wrong value. We need to find out the wrong value, that our data has certain erroneous values in it. Which of the following normalization technique which you use to normalize data with such erroneous values is the question. Or how it finds out erroneous value also we can look at in another perspective. Or we can look at how to normalize. What is normalize is the question. Yesterday we touched upon normalize. May hear from you a few words, normalize, normalization, normal distribution, bell curve, Gaussian curve, or Gaussian distribution.
Data which, the plots normally without outliers.
Yeah, it is distributed normally. What is the meaning here? This is the given data set. Age of Kendra Vidyalaya student. If you look at predominantly, see 120-year guy never ever exist in this Kali Yuga, living with 120 years. That blessed person cannot go and sit in the Kendra Vidyalaya to study. This is called outlier. One more concept we are jumping into from one buzzword to another buzzword. However, I'll come back. This is outlier. Yesterday we discussed Ambani and the person who scores 2 marks will disturb the entire class. This is outlier. That is one situation. That's fine. But what is normal distribution? The given data set, we may need to plot. A simple way of understanding is plotting. Understanding whether the data is normally distributed or not, we have several techniques. Kurtosis, scatter plot, box plot, histogram, so many things. This is one such thing, normal curve distribution. If the data, after plotting this data, if we look at this resemblance, then it is normally distributed. Otherwise not. It should take the bell shape, exactly the bell shape or more or less this bell shape. If not, it is not normally distributed. If it is not normally distributed, we cannot ask the vendor to give the normalized data. I cannot work on it. None of the statistical tools work with the data which is not in the normalized form. We can't say. We may need to normalize. There are 3 normalization techniques available: Z-score, min-max, log transform. How the after normalizing the entire data, how it would look, we are going to see in a couple of minutes. However, we are trying to introduce 3 types of normalization technique. What is the use of normalization technique? Mainly, it will distribute the data into normality. It will resemble the bell shape. That is the main advantage. Any data is of normal in nature that works well with a machine learning model or statistical model. Now, this is the data set given. What I supposed to do? We are going for one more package called NumPy. We are using import NumPy. And one mistake I have committed, 1 minute, jumbled this coding. NumPy as NP should come. Wait a minute. Oh, 1 second. This coding is jumbled. How it is jumbled is NP dot input NumPy as NP. Okay, now it's correct. So what we are trying to do is we are using a list of all the given data set we are loading into list. The moment it is loaded to the list and the ARR, and this also let me mute, not required. Something happened wrong. Okay. Import NumPy as NP. This is the package useful for numerical operations. This NumPy is meant for numerical operation. We are creating alias name as NP. Next, what we are doing, the given data set is loaded into ARR. This is the Kendra Vidyalaya student's age. Immediately, we are going to calculate mean value. That mean value we are trying to print with X. Now, let's look at how the mean value is given by this code. The mean value is 20.7. Next, we are trying to calculate. For the Z-score calculation, I'm trying to tell on the same data set, NP standard deviation. Z-score calculation, the formula is XI minus mean divided by standard deviation. I'll just write Z-score value is, formula is XI. The individual value minus mean mu divided by standard deviation. This is mathematical formula. But here I am using variable instead of mu as x, instead of sigma as y. That is the only difference. What is ARRI? The Kendra Vidyalaya student's age. In the previous cell we have seen. This is the age of Kendra Vidyalaya students. This age started loading into array value. Then Z score is calculated. The Z score goes up to for I in range of length of array. Whatever the number of elements available in array, do as many time. We no need to sit and calculate how many Kendra Vidyalaya students are given. Really, these are all right or not. We no need to count. Already we introduced the length function for the list. That length only we are using. It gives us length of the array. That length of array will be guiding this for loop how many times it needs to execute. Then array of I minus X divided by Y. This is the Z score value. Now let us watch this closely. Z score finds out erroneous value distinctly. The fifth person is 120 years blessed person is studying in Kendra Vidyalaya. It makes it clearly shows 3.7 is an outlier. All other data is normalized. See, it looks like same. The moment we start plotting this data, it would resemble the bell curve. Only 3.7 is standing out. If we go back and look at the data, this is the position 120. This 120 is standing out or erroneous data. Normally in school education, students will be having the age up to 18 years old, at the max are 20 years old. But definitely not 120 year old student will be studying in Kendra Vidyalaya school. So the erroneous data given here is this. Out of these three normalization, Z score only will help us to find out erroneous data. Although all the three techniques are used for normalization, Z score will help us to find out the erroneous data. Now let us move to one more, min-max normalization for the same data, the Kendra Vidyalaya age. For that, this is the formula. X value, X array value minus min divided by max minus min. Like how we have done for Z score, similarly, xi minus min of that class, min of that group, that sample, min, max of that sample. A section, the minimum mark would be 0. B section, not necessarily. The minimum mark can be 25 also. A section, maximum mark could be 100. Not necessarily in the B section. B section, maximum mark could be 40 also. So among the given set, we may need to use this max and min and individual value. Use this formula. Need to calculate min-max value for each and every item of the given array. Now the normalized value for the given Kendra Vidyalaya data set is this. If we plot this data, although given original data is not normal, I don't know, I haven't plotted, but I'm trying to tell. If it is not taking the bell curve shape, after this normalization technique, it will take bell curve shape. Most of the time. Not all the time. Although we apply all the three normalization techniques, some of the data would not go to normal form. We cannot do anything for that. We need to proceed further. That's it. So now that 120 data is the highest data that is distinctly given by min-max. The least age of the data set is 11. That is given with 00. This has its own beauty. It starts distinguishing the highest data value and lowest data value, min-max normalization. Log normalization, all of us know, taking log value, directly taking log value, no more formula. Given the Kendra Vidyalaya data set, we need to take log of this fellow, this fellow, this fellow, that's it. Now we are slowly getting into visual plot. Matplotlib, this is the visual plot. This is another visual plot. So this plot section, we can touch upon tomorrow. Again, we will be revisiting back. Z score normalization and min-max scaling or normalization. I think with this we can wind up today's session. We will be meeting back on Tuesday evening. Till then I am having some external assignment. So I supposed to travel. So I'll be back to my hometown on Tuesday. So I wish to connect with you on Tuesday. Thank you. Any questions you can open up. Otherwise, we can sign off each other. Hi, everyone. Are you there? Shall we sign off?
Yeah, fine. We will practice on it today's class.
Yeah, definitely.
So when you will back on Tuesday?
Tuesday, yeah.
Okay, fine.
Yeah, that PPT, that PPT and this notebook tomorrow I'll be into busy schedule. I'm conducting workshop for the whole day. So Friday, if possible, probably I'll be sharing all the stuff with the condenser. So you may be able to get from condenser only the one point of correspondence. This notebook and that PPTs I will share with the condenser. You can get back and you can work on it. That what each buzzword says, that terminology, because Z score, min max, it involves with mathematical intricacies. We may need to really understand to the core level so that we can interpret much more. When the moment data is given in larger volume, we may not able to look back to the smaller tiny details. We may need to go with the high pedestrian of understanding higher mathematical model so that you can work on the PPT as well on this notebook. So this for hands-on, that's for knowledge elevation. So with that, we can meet on Tuesday. I think that stuff is more than sufficient. So these two, we work on, the time will go on. Is that okay?
Yeah, okay.
Okay, fine. Thank you. See you all. I'll stop the... Anything else? Shall I stop the... close our Zoom meeting?
You can close it.
Yeah.